This is Toon Talk Weekly, episode 254. This week, Brad and I go back into the Hanna-Barbera vault when we check out the 1975 series, The Great Grape Ape Show.
Flight 208, you are clear for takeoff on runway 7.
Roger. Sorry, Mac, but there's no way we can take off with that load of ape. You'll just have to walk.
Walk? Hey, man, now I did not think of that before. Come on, Grape Ape. We are taking the scenic route.
Thanks.
Grape Ape, you're welcome.
Day just keeps getting better. Yeah. Ah, boy.
Hey everyone, welcome back to Toon Talk Weekly. This is the weekly cartoon podcast where we chat about a different cartoon. My name is Jake Williams, but I don't do the show alone. I got my good buddy Brad Chmielewski here to talk cartoons again. What's up, man?
Hey, how's it going?
It's going well, dude. It's been a fine evening. Or evening, I mean weekend.
Weekend.
Yeah, the weekend's been great, aside from the, you know, getting caught in the rain walking the dog. That was the only downside this weekend. How's your weekend been?
It's going pretty well over here. It's Illinois Craft Beer Week, so there's plenty of drinking to be had.
I mean, you can never complain about that.
Right.
I don't know if Michigan, if this area like Southeast Detroit, like has a Craft Beer Week, but I should look into that.
Well, there's always America Craft Beer Week or that happens. I think it's like in a couple weeks or a month.
Is there a cartoon, and maybe this is non-existent because usually they're targeted towards kids, around like a bartender or bar, like Cheers the animated series or something?
I guess Simpsons are the closest.
That's true. They do go to a bar quite a bit, and Family Guy in the same vein, right?
Mm-hmm.
But like, how is there no Tapper the series?
Yeah, just problems you face with the bartender fixes the problems or whatever.
I bet. Didn't Wreck-It Ralph, the animated film, have a Tapper reference in it?
Yeah, it did.
So I don't think Tapper's like nostalgia stock is high. I think because of barcades these days, Tapper has become way more popular than it ever was.
I think so. You're right.
You know, like a bunch of us craft beer nerds who are like, oh, check it out, a beer game. Like, I'm playing it. But I think the time is right for a Tapper-like web series. Like, you have Tapper, the bartender, is like the main guy, and he's got to go to work, and episodes center around like patrons that come in with problems, and then he helps them like solve their problems.
I like that idea. We should get it rolling.
We probably have to just call it something different.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the vein. Like the idea that like friendly bartender, don't make him like a full blown superhero, but make him like he's a problem solver. He's a fixer. He's a guy.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what we do. We come up with new cartoons on this show.
That one's pretty good. It feels like the art and the general or the core of the episode takes place in one place, so it's not too in-depth to, like, make.
Well, and then I was trying to, like, figure out, like, okay, well, you want to center around the bar because he's the bartender and that kind of thing, and maybe he's got, like, a signature catchphrase or, like, a, you know, a way he slides the drink at the end before the credits or something like that. But I was thinking, like, maybe they have outside problems, so there is a reason to go on an adventure or something.
Right, yeah.
But, yeah, I don't know. Maybe that's worth thinking up a pilot. That's pretty good. Pretty good. But welcome in, everybody, to Toon Talk Weekly. Every single week for the last few years, Brad and I have been diving into a brand new cartoon. Brand new meaning different, right? Not necessarily always the newest, latest, and greatest. That's what this week is. We're going back to 1975 to talk about The Great Grape Ape Show, which I didn't know was its own show.
No, I didn't know either. But we also, like, in the, like, although we're going back, we did get news on, like, the next latest and greatest show that will be coming out here soon, or in 2019, Thundercats Roar.
Yeah, oh, okay, so it has a subtitle, right? Roar? to it. Okay. Yeah, I put that in the show notes. You can find over with the episode at toontalkweekly@gmail.com, plus over on our Twitter at toontalkweekly. But Brad tipped me off to a new post that actually has like a 3 to 4 minute behind the scenes featurette about the brand new series Thundercats Roar coming to, I believe, Cartoon Network.
Right. And this show and all this has kicked off just war on Twitter. On the fact that like people are getting mad that all these cartoons look the same, and they're getting mad that Thundercats is getting rebooted in the style that looks just like all these other shows. There's no originality, blah, 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 blah. I am in the camp that Thundercats, the original, sucks a lot.
I think you said that on our episode when we talked about it.
I am more than happy to see this get rebooted in like a fun new way, because everyone is trying to, I think, sit on the fence like, oh, this show was great, it defined my childhood, da da da. No, it's bad. You obviously have not watched it in a long time. It might be great, and it served the purpose when you were a kid, and that's wonderful. Now guess what? This new cartoon might not be for you. It's for kids today. So suck it.
You heard it here from Brad, guys. Your childhood sucked. If Thundercats is the thing you base it on.
No, it did fine for your childhood. It's great. You shouldn't... we live in a world where we can go back and watch any of that no matter what, and we go through with a fine-tooth comb, as we're going to do here with the Great Ape, but they don't hold up. But they served a purpose then. Like, you enjoyed it, so you have that. Like, them rebooting a show and doing something different doesn't hurt your memories of the show.
Okay, so that's your opinion then of the new look of the show, which we should say for the viewers, if you haven't checked out, definitely check out the links that we tweeted out or the show notes. But the look, I'm going to say, is very much in line with the Bee and Puppy Cats, the OKKOs, the sort of like soft-lined, chubby, cute, chibi mm-hmm. almost version of a lot of modern cartoons. Steven Universe even. Actually, the characters remind me a lot of Steven Universe because everything's just like rounder and a little bit smaller and squishier, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you're of the opinion like, hey, like if they're gonna whether they take a property or not, they're just updating a thing and there's no real reason to be mad at it, or you're just not into the reason that people are mad about it.
Yeah, like, so what, they're rebooting it, like, either you don't have to watch the new one, you can have you can have your old one. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't, and the people that are upset are maybe in cartoons now or still watch cartoons, and they want to see new stuff. But at the same time, if you didn't watch cartoons, if you were an investment banker and you watched Thundercats when you were a kid, you probably don't even know this show is getting rebooted.
Yeah, so I'm of the opinion, when I saw the trailer, I thought it was cool to go back and see kind of like see the creator talk about the guy who's like bringing it to life. So I have to imagine at some point this got pitched. And, you know, someone's like, oh, we should reboot this. I was a big fan when I was a kid. That seems to be the impetus to why this is even going on. Mm-hmm. I'm in a weird place because the thing that bugged me about the behind the scenes featurette was the creator or one of the artists or somebody mentioned like, hey, Thundercats was kind of ridiculous anyway. So now we're going to play up that comedy bit, but also make sure we have action. I think that's a modern problem. And by that, I mean, we look back and we do it a lot on this show. In fact, that's part of the reason this show exists, is like, it is so easy now to take a critical eye at entertainment things, especially old ones, and say, look how ridiculous this is. You know, look how ridiculous that episode of Transformers was, that a kid in a wheelchair was beating a robot, like in a race or something.
Right.
You know, and then it brings me back to that we talked about with Chad Ashley on the Looney Tunes episode, that Netflix series, Toys That Made Us, and yeah. It brought me back to He-Man and how, you know, man, I know you have a lot of nostalgic value for these things, but a lot of them were made in a boardroom, and sometimes they were just thrown to the wall and hope they stuck. And you know what? You bought the toy. You convinced your parents you really needed the toy, and you went and bought it. And so right.
the cartoon might have been good, but it was made to sell that toy.
Right. So I think that our generation, or this modern generation of people making cartoons, seems to, I think we hold a more romantic vision of what we want, and like embodying these stories or wanting to tell these stories with characters and worlds and things that we love, versus before, and I'm not saying this is black and white here, but before when they were making cartoons, a lot of it was down to it was a business decision. It wasn't like they were in love with the idea of Skeletor doing this or the Thundercats doing this or that thing. So I think we put more like romantic weight on it, some more feeling into it. I think the art and animation looks good to me. I guess. I could just care less that it is Thundercats or that it's a previous property, right? Like it could just be an adventure show.
Right. They could have changed the names and been like, I don't know, Jungle Fighters or, you know, whatever they were, Cat Fighters.
Right. And so I guess...
Would people have been as upset?
Yeah, I think it's the people who grew up loving Thundercats or still think they love Thundercats that really have a problem with it. But you're right, dude. For new kids, they're going to see Thundercats roar. This is a style that appeals to kids these days because these are the cartoons that they know. If you tried to make a show that looked like G.I. Joe or Transformers or Thundercats from the past, kids would be like, what the hell is this?
Right. And the style, you know, it is a kind of a style right now, but it also translates really well across like devices. Like Thundercats, the old one, scaling it down for if you were watching on your mobile phone, it would look muddy because there's not a lot of detail in there, but it looks fine on TV where, you know, Steven Universe, it can get scaled up to a movie and it looks great, and it gets scaled down super tiny to your phone and it still looks good.
So it's kind of interesting. I thought that I didn't really look into it, but I kind of thought what you're saying is the case is that the internet was probably a little upset because the style looks like other stuff. And then it's also a nostalgic property. There's like a couple of pillars here that could just tip people off to just be their like breaking point to be tilted.
Yeah. So there's they call it the CalArt style right now, but it's no different than saying all the 3D animated movies have the Pixar style. And it's like, they did for like a minute, but at the same time, they're all animated different, and they only look that way because people may have worked at Pixar or went to CalArts.
Right.
It's like saying, we were talking beer earlier, it's like, all this beer tastes like a beer from Goose Island. It's like, well, Goose Island employed a lot of people that went to start other breweries.
Yeah.
So
probably learned some stuff there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just a weird social thing where when stuff starts rising to the top because one thing got popular. There will always be other offshoots. Like you have to imagine if this is the CalArt style or whatever they're calling it, it took us a while to get here to Thundercats, and whether it went from like Adventure Time to Steven Universe to Clarence to this or something, like clearly those shows worked, so it influences the ones that move on forward, right? So that's gonna it's just gonna happen. But I do kind of see a world where I could look at the Cartoon Network like app and all the thumbnails for the shows, and if it didn't have a title next to it, I'd be like, is this all the same show? Like,
that's true. Yeah,
you know, there's only a few, I think, to me that look, they are all different in their own ways. We can see the different details. We're definitely generalizing the style, but you know, if I look at them now, I'm sitting here going like, well, Teen Titans definitely looks different. And then everything else, like, I don't know. So quite a bit there. But go check out the behind the scenes. It's definitely fun to see people working on it. And of course, I mean, we'd never wish ill on people. Of course, we want the show to do well. Like, people put a lot of hard work into it. So get in the discussion online, because apparently it's pretty heated. But we're not talking about that today. Today, we're going to talk about The Great Grape Ape Show, 1975 series produced by Hanna-Barbera Productions. It broadcasts on ABC from September to December in that year of 75, and then in syndication reruns until the 78. Directed by Charles A. Nichols, one season, 16 total episodes, and it was originally broadcast alongside Tom and Jerry. So kind of makes sense there. The funny thing is, dude, if I'm going through a tier list, we're talking like video games here, of Hanna-Barbera characters, Grape Ape is like middle of the road, bottom tier in my mind.
Yeah, he's not even on my tier list because I didn't know he was a thing.
You didn't know who Grape Ape was?
I have never heard of this character before.
So I don't know about the mythos or anything, if there is a bigger story to Grape Ape. I've always known the Grape Ape character, but truthfully, because this was before my time, this was probably more that I knew Grape Ape from like when Cartoon Network was doing Boomerang on their network before they spun it off.
Right, okay.
And I probably saw him in some, you know, some promos, and I was like, who's this big Grape Ape that just only says Grape Ape all the time? So I don't know. When I think of Hanna-Barbera characters, Grape Ape is not one that comes to mind. But dude, as soon as you watch the show, you're in a Hanna-Barbera world. Like, you can feel it.
Oh, for sure. Especially Grape Ape's friend is basically Quick Draw McGraw, or like he looks like the Hanna-Barbera character. You're like, mm-hmm. why is that guy here? But that's not him.
No, his name is Beagle. Beagle.
Yeah, or what's the dog or the droopy? Mm-hmm. I don't know. It just looks like he's like, wait, is that? No, it's not. Why isn't that him?
Him, and then also I'll say the people, the human character designs, reminded me so much of Hanna-Barbera stuff. But of course they made it, so of course it does. Mm-hmm. I was trying to nail down how to describe the story of Grape Ape, what you can expect from an episode, and there are only 16 episodes. Really, dude, they should redo this and do it in the CalArts style, and then we'll have like a cool, like Grape Ape could be a cool dude.
Yeah, that could be fun.
But if you're gonna do that, like for me, for my generation, could you just make a Donkey Kong Country show again? Like, make a good one? There was a weird 3D one in the 90s, and it was not great.
Oh, yeah.
So how do we describe what happens in this? All I can say is it's like episode starts, and they go on some sort of adventure caper kind of thing. That's it. Like, there's no formula as to, like, there's no end goal. It's just, I think these shows rely on the pillar of, here's a character we've created, watch them do things. I don't think it needs to be any deeper than that, really.
But they also do things. This is a very Hanna-Barbera, I think that like late 70s, 80s time, where a lot of their characters were just like fish oil salesmen. Like, hey, I'm gonna trick you into giving me something. And that is so much a Hanna-Barbera. And that's what we saw with this one episode where I watched. I'm sure the other one was the same way, but it's like, let's trick these people into giving us free food and it'll be great.
It's like cartoons in that vein were kind of like, let's pull a little prank, like the Yogi Bear, right?
Yeah.
Let's steal this thing from me. But it's kind of funny because I'm a bear or I'm an ape or I'm a whatever. So.
Right. But it creates this horrible moral compass, right? For any kid that's watching, like, well, I can just trick my parents and I'll get something out of this.
Yeah. Nice. Some common things would be that in these episodes are typically when people see Grape Ape, who can speak, but speaks almost more like a caveman and like shorted breaths, and always has his name, Grape Ape, as a sort of, I mean, he's just a Pokemon, really. He says his name as like a way of agreeing with people, or like agreeing to a sentiment a lot.
Yeah.
And then what you have is people will see him and get super scared, but he doesn't mean poorly at all. He's got a calm demeanor, really. He's just a happy-go-lucky ape, really. It's Beagle, his little guy, who's like, eh, let's get the scam together. But even he doesn't seem like... It's not dastardly scams.
No.
They're not trying to hurt anybody. But yeah,
no, they want stuff for drifters.
Yeah, that's a good one. The drifters. so we have a couple episodes here today. We'll talk mostly about this first one, which was called That Was No Idol, That Was My Ape. And each of these episodes are about 10 or 11 minutes long. I did notice that I think there's a lot of Boomerang content or Hanna-Barbera content on, I already forgot. I think it's on YouTube, and I feel like you can buy them for like 99 cents an episode. So they're not, okay. They're pretty readily available. This episode, dude, the plot right now, I will tell you, if it seems familiar, it's because one of the episodes of, was it Heathcliff? I think it was the episode of Heathcliff we watched that had the exact same plot.
I think this every sitcom has done this story, every cartoon, no matter what it is. I feel like we also watched the episode of, could it have been the dinosaur one? The Cadillacs and Dinosaurs, where this was a plot.
Oh, I think so. Dude. Like, okay, so sometimes when we choose cartoons, I do it by description when I pick episodes, and I go like, okay, Christmas story, okay, lost pet story, okay, you know, I don't know. There's some pretty standard stuff that happens in cartoons. And so when we come back across stuff like this, which is the overall arching plot of the episode is come across a group of people, pretend to be the thing that they worship you until they find out. Right.
Like, right. It's often some sort of foreign villagers on an island.
Mm-hmm.
That's, yeah.
So that happens here in this episode. That was no idol. That was my ape. It begins with Grape Ape and Beagle. Beagle kind of traveling, and they're just on their regular roads, but it's all rainy and crappy out. And they see a billboard for Hawaii and think, we should go there. We got to get out of here. This place sucks. It's all bad weather here. One mention real quick is that I love how they travel, which is they have this really cool looking fat little cute van that Beagle drives, but Grape Ape like stands on top of it.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost like a little skateboard.
Yeah.
So they want to go to Hawaii. So they get on a plane and they strap Grape Ape to the top of it. But the pilot has to tell them, like, dude, we can't bring your 40-foot ape on this plane. It's not going to get off anywhere.
We can't take off. Yeah.
No. So what do they decide to do instead? Just swim.
No, they're going to walk. They walk.
Oh, walk. Excuse me. And by walking, they basically, Grape Ape here can walk along the ocean floor while Beagle rests on his hand and he holds him up above the water. And you get some great classic cartoons of things of like a fish going through his ear and he like yeah. his
and
eyes
Grape follow Ape
it.
Can somehow breathe underwater.
Now just remember, Grape Ape, I am doing the driving.
Grape Ape, Grape Ape.
Now make a right turn at the next whale, and that'll take us straight to Hawaii.
Grape Ape, dead ahead, sir.
Grape what? No! Let's get out of here!
I thought they were gonna, like, he was gonna have trouble and they'd have to come up with, like, some sort of gag of, like, here, let me get this tree and use it as a snorkel.
Yeah.
They were just like, yeah, you can breathe underwater. We'll go with
that. There's also a great little moment here where Grape Ape, his mouth was moving under the water and the bubbles came up and popped and it made the sounds of him saying Grape Ape up above the surface. It was fun. I also liked there was a fun cartoon thing when he flattened the plane before they took off walking. He like wrung it out or like whipped it out like you would dry a shirt or a towel that you were going to fold or something. So that was fun. So they get to this island and they come across a group of natives who are sort of dancing and worshiping around this giant statue that sort of looks like a giant ape. So they decide to do exactly what Brad mentioned earlier, which is, hey, that kind of looks like you. The next scene cuts to the statue laying on its side, like covered a little bit poorly in some brush. And then Grape Ape is now standing on top of the pedestal and people are worshiping him. And they're so confused because now the statue that they've been worshiping can talk.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Beagle being with him convinces like, yeah, I speak for him. So like, if we need some stuff, like, you know, we're together. Like, they pretend to be the statue that they are known as on this island called Momo, basically. And they get exactly what you said, Brad, bunch of food, relaxing, laying in hammocks, that kind of thing.
But then they need to stop Mumu, Momba.
Momo,
I don't know. They basically need to stop the volcano from erupting. And that was Mumu's job or Great Ape's job.
Now, remember what I told you?
Right. Grape Ape, Momo, yeah.
Me, Chief. You rang?
Oh, no, your native chieftainship. It was my friend here, Momo.
Momo?
Momo! Momo!
Hey, you guys! Momo here's on your side!
Our side?
Oh, sure is! So bring on the food and let's celebrate!
It is as the prophecy says! When Momo becomes angry, Momo will appear!
So what I can't figure out is that there is like a moment here where Grape Ape sneezes and then they get chased. Why did sneezing like cause these villagers to be like, you're not the guy? He didn't like have anything on. There was no like outfit.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah.
It was so weird. But yeah, then there is this volcano erupting and it says eventually some prophet says like, you know, eventually Momo will show up and he'll be angry and it's up to you to like stop this. They're still running from these villagers. They're hiding up in this volcano and it's about to erupt. And Grape Ape is actually about to sneeze once again. He doesn't want to. He takes this giant hunk of rock and plugs up the volcano. But dude, it's a volcano. That's not going to work. Launches this giant hunk of rock up into the air and it spikes a hole into the island and the island just starts sinking. So they've walked all the way to quote unquote Hawaii, which clearly they ended up on some other island, and sunk their island. However, their solution is, we can just make you a new one. And the final scene of the episode is a sideways turned giant statue that they had been the imposters of. They laid on its side, planted some trees, and then swam away. They're like, have fun. You live on a statue now. So this was pretty mean, really.
Yeah, they destroyed the island and then, like, here, live on this floating statue that, you know, isn't going to survive.
Yeah, and, you know, even if they seemed fine with it, but also when they left, dude, they swam. So why didn't he walk away? I'm confused here. What's going on, Grape Ape? Suddenly you can swim. So that was the first episode. I know you didn't catch it, but I'll quickly go through the second episode, dude, which is called The Big Parade. It involves an evil, dastardly villain, the classic type with, you know, the long chin, the long nose, and the mustache, and a diamond heist, basically. He has a diamond, and they need to get it out of the city that they're in. So their way of doing this is they have control of, there's a big parade going on, they have control of this giant floating blue balloon woman, or female, like, floating balloon. So they put the diamond in its mouth, and of course, as it's flying away, Grape Ape and Beagle follow it because Grape Ape is now in love. Grape Ape wants to be in love with this giant parade float.
Plan 6, balloons, mouth, remove diamond. Plan 6, balloons, mouth, remove diamond. Plan 6, balloons, mouth.
Hey, Duke, the pink Palamazoo ain't here. Besides, you're colorblind. This here ain't no baby blue balloon ape. This here's a purple real ape that says,
a real 40-foot purple ape?
Grape Ape.
Essentially follows them back to their hideout. They go to retrieve the diamond, but there's all these funny gags of like, oh, I'm reaching into the balloon, but it's actually Grape Ape and whatever. The entire episode ends with a tug of war in the sky between Grape Ape holding a helicopter in one hand, trying to stop the bad guys from getting away, and Beagle controlling the flying balloon on the other side because he now has the controller. Until basically all of the pieces of the helicopter shatter and they capture the bad guys and save the day. It's kind of a it's kind of a weird thing. There's also a great shot in the end when they throw the villains in jail. Instead of putting them in jail, Grape Ape like pulls down one of the walls of the jail, tosses them in, and then puts the wall back because he's so huge. So it's a weird, like, Grape Ape's in love with a balloon story but doesn't realize she's not a real gorilla, but they also save the day. Like, he stumbles into saving the day. So less of a prank on people in that one, but a fun one nonetheless.
All right, that's good.
So we did catch a couple of episodes. Again, mentioned there's 16 total. But Brad, general thoughts. This is your first experience ever with Grape Ape. Like, where do you sit on this cartoon?
I will not be watching or seeing any more. It's fine. Mm-hmm. It's a Hanna-Barbera cartoon. Like, you could throw it on Boomerang, and it's, you know, that's pretty much all Hanna-Barbera. Mm-hmm. And you could just have it on. It's almost like background stuff. You know what's going to happen. You know the stories. They may have been the first ones to do it, but they have been recycled over and over again. So you know exactly what's going to happen.
Yeah, it's kind of funny going to this because I think there are way more popular Hanna-Barbera cartoons. So this seems like an extra one that was made to see, like, well, we'll see what happens. And fill it. But man, I had fun. Like, again, I'm with you. I'm not going to go out of my way to probably check out a lot more. But for kind of knowing the character, but not really knowing he had his own show, it's like, it's classic Saturday morning stuff. It's exactly it's exactly the amount of time you need. It's simple stories, and sometimes it can be funny, especially, like, I don't know, looking at it with a modern edge of like, why did he do that sort of thing? That can be fun. But not in my vault of like, not on my list of like, I need to go check out more, but definitely fun to finally see the show and know a little bit more about Grape Ape and know that he has his own show.
Right. Yeah.
So cool. Well, I think without further ado, let's get out of here. I liked, we had a good discussion, man. Good discussion of the new stuff up in the beginning, I think. And then also like covering Grape Ape. More controversial new cartoons should come out so we can debate them on here.
So we can talk them. Yeah.
Yeah. So let's get out of here. Brad, where can people find out more about you when you're not recording Toon Talk Weekly?
So you can follow me on Twitter. It's @brad, and then my blog is digitalhitchhiker.com.
guys, go check them out over there. You can follow me on Twitter if you'd like, at Jacob Williams. And of course, anywhere the show is, we're probably all over the internet. At Toon Talk Weekly on Twitter, Facebook.com/Toon Talk Weekly, Instagram.com/Toon Talk Weekly. We're over on Google Plus as Toon Talk Weekly as well. Our email, ToonTalkWeekly@gmail.com. You can send us notes, letters, messages, fan mail, whatever. I don't know. What do you want to call it? You can
letters.
Letters. Send us letters. We'll send you our address. I'm not even kidding.
Box, Toon Talk Weekly.
Wallaby, Sydney. No, what is that? Anyway, Finding Nemo reference. And ToonTalkWeekly.com is the main hub for the show. Any and all episodes, including episode 101, where we talk about Thundercats a long time ago. So you can get Brad's true opinions, which are on there on the internet forever. So you can't take them back.
No, that's fine. I stand by all opinions.
I stand by what I said. But this has been another fun episode. Thank you so much for listening. We'll be back next week with another cartoon.
Take care.
To learn more about the show, visit ToonTalkWeekly.com or follow us on Twitter @ToonTalkWeekly.